voters to make decisions on whether to take projects forward or not. Surely each, we have a director for each individual business area, and the whole point of the executive is to then make the decisions as to whether to take them forward or not. So I don't really understand how we got to the position where the governance and the executive failed so catastrophically that we've had to employ more officers to make the decisions on whether to carry forward the projects on them. So I know you'll have to tread tentatively on that particular topic, but please enlighten me as to why you believe it's been necessary in the first instance. The second one, on the finance and law not being involved to start the projects. I find that unbelievably difficult to understand how that can be the case when we're talking about multi-million-pound projects in some instances, and how that hasn't always been normal working practice. So again, it's a complete and total failure on the executive part, so I have to have yourself to actually instill in them that it's necessary. But an example that I'm leading into that, let's say for argument's sake, there was one business area that wanted to acquire property, and then there's another one, a regeneration project, and another one, a PR project, like a newspaper for argument's sake. So all of these individual business areas go about their own business with their own financial restraints that they have to work with under, but they have no idea how their impact is going to affect any of the other business areas. Is that what we're actually saying before this investment and change board was instilled? And the other one is business cases not being completed. So again, are we saying that business cases for particular projects over the last, it doesn't matter how long, 10, 15, 20 years, have been put forward again to the executive, incomplete, and what they've been signed off and we just carried out anyway, even though they actually didn't quite fit the purpose. So again, is that ultimately what we're suggesting? And that is one of the areas that the investment and change board has had to look into.
So,
So
there's no additional staff been employed for investment change board. These are all the existing staff in the authority that have just come together to take a whole sort of corporate view, really. What was in place before, I would say, was fit for purpose for what would happen before in the council. So over the past sort of 12 months, 2 years, the council has changed quite significantly. We've got quite a lot more significant large multi-million projects, as you say, that have come on board. So, for example, the Rural Water, Rural Growth. These projects have not happened before. So without these projects, there's been no need for an investment change board. So I put this in place to make sure that we had overall oversight of all these projects. So as I say, you know, what was there before was probably fit for purpose of what we were doing. In the past, each corporate director has accountability for their own budget, and they still have that now. But they were managing their budgets and they were managing their finances within their overall accountability. That was managed adequately correctly, because you know the council hasn't overspent significantly in previous years. Because of our financial situation where we are now, and because of all these major projects, I just felt that there was a necessity to put in more governance to make sure that we absolutely, really couldn't, you know, make sure that we were completely tight on everything and all the governance, and that everybody in the council was cited in whatever was going on. Whereas, as I say, probably before there was no necessity for that much governance to be in place. So when I came forward, this is best practice kind of from where I worked before, especially with major projects and large mail things. So I just felt that that was, from my perspective, it was missing for me to give the overall corporate oversight of that. In terms of business cases, so business cases have always been completed. So there's never been a major project without a business case. But what I found was that business cases were being completed in their own areas. And for something significant for a road company or Rural Waters, what we needed was one business case that everybody fed into, and it was a consistent and a standard format. So working with the transformation team as well, we've got a new process now for, it's always been there, it's more rigorous now in terms of what business cases are completed. Three stages to a business case. It has to go through each one before it goes any further. And you know, before, I think that was kind of done on a case-by-case basis rather than a whole council basis.
And I think in terms of your question about finance and legal not being involved, that was more multi-million project, so it might have been on smaller projects. So where the overall accountability for the budget was rested with the corporate director. And once it went to cabinet, so if something was gone through cabinet, finance and legal would always be cited before it goes to cabinet. So these were small things that perhaps weren't key decisions that didn't go through cabinet decisions. And there were, you know, there were only small projects that were within the accountability of the director. So it's another process that I actually put in place to make sure that officers are completely happy with everything and that all the questions can be answered and all the evidence is available for members to make an informed decision on these new projects that we've got come online.
Further answers, Tom Dawes. Joe, I was just going to underscore that, so this is best practice. And one of the interviews is so that where previously there may have been lots of individual projects under separate directorates that would come for legal, financial, HR advice, this allows that advice to be given in the one place. So same people, same resources, but actually concentrated in one place. What that provides is the two things that you raised there. So one is greater cross-understanding, the same people at the same time understanding the impact of one project on another. And the other being this provides for a gateway and an obvious place for people to come. And so that because that advice is then captured in a corporate way, rather than within the different ways that each director or each chief officer might have done it previously in their own way, it means things can be captured quite early. So that the right kind of investment to bring that to fruition, or actually at the proper early stage, someone would be said, that's a lovely idea, but it's not going to go anywhere, so get it now, because otherwise it could be a waste of money. So it allows that level of corporate governance as opposed to the individual director of governance. And that's something that's been reflected not just in this board, but in other boards now established across the council to increase corporate governance and oversight.
I'm mindful to tell you that people want to get
it. Yeah, it's while it's fetching you, man. While I appreciate that the focus of the council has changed, and I can see what you're saying, that there is a need for improved governance, and this structure will actually provide that. I think that's a reasonable assertion. What we're also saying, this isn't to sound denigrating, so please don't take it this way. So some of these projects that are written off because they're never going to come to fruition and we don't believe it's a good value for money, those decisions should still be resting with elected members, and it should not be for officers to make making those decisions, because ultimately the people who will fall on the sword are the elected individuals, and then the cabinet members should still be accountable. You are responsible for actually bringing them to the board, but it should always be clear and transparent that the ultimate, this particular instance, Stuart, if it was under his remit, is accountable at the end of the day. So I appreciate the extra level of governance, and I think it's fantastic that you realise that it wasn't as good as it could be, but ultimately it shouldn't haze anyone's view as to who actually makes the ultimate decision, or should be making the ultimate decision on whether we actually have any projects forward or not.
Thanks for those comments and those, Councillor Blakeley.
Thanks, Chair. First thing is, thanks for that report, Chair. Can I ask why the report was late? Can I ask why, you know, all council officers are the dates of committees, therefore they know the dates to submit reports, and yet in this case this wasn't submitted in time, it was delivered late last week. It was the same with the business case for the highways. And I just think officers need to ensure we have the reports in plenty of time to give them the proper reading and proper scrutiny. And my solution is really simple. If an officer can't get reported on time, then it doesn't come to the show, is it? It is that simple. And I would ask the Chair that you make officers aware of that. Now, looking at this report, first thing to say is lots and lots of acronyms in terms of, you know, ACG, ICB, PMO, okay. Some are explained, some aren't. I don't know what ACG stands for. What does ACG stand for? don't know what stands for, how do we expect the public who are reading these documents online to be able to understand? This is council speak. This needs to be in layman's terms so people understand what's going to do. So I find this quite incredible that we've allowed a document like this to go on the website. Going forward, at the budgets, workshop, for want of a better saying, we talked about the number of companies, we talked about council assets, and elected members are understanding that the council assets will go into the number of company, and our partner news will provide the finance and bring in the private finance. Now, examiners were going out buying further assets to throw into this. And this council, and you said yourself, here, you know, massive budget deficit. We seem to find money for anything we want to find money for. There always seems to be a money tree somewhere hiding in this town hall. And for all we're told, we've got no money. I'm sorry, that's not to wear with them, because I believe this council has lots and lots of money, and we just don't know what it is. So I find that disingenuous as well. And you spoke about, in answer to Tony Cox, that the board exists for existing staff. Not true. You know, we've got the growth lead, Stuart Halliday, who was a consultant on £600 a day. £600 a day on this board. If he wasn't on this board, then that's, for each day this board sits, that would be £600 as council. So, you know, please bring us accurate information, Stuart. Not information you think you'll just swallow, because I'm not swallowing a consultant on £600 a day as being existing staff. Perhaps you'd like to comment on that.
Just before you do, regarding your comments on the access, I'll make sure things are here before that. That's important. Share.
Thank you, Chair. So, just a couple of points I'd like to respond on for that, really. In terms of the council budget, and just the comments about having lots of money, it's my responsibility, Section 1 of our officer, to make sure that the budget that we've got is accurate, and that we can balance the budget over 12 months. We have to set a statutory budget next year, and then also for the 4 years. In terms of being able to balance that budget, it's been a very difficult, painful process. It's been 12 months in the making, really. And I would just like to respond to say that if the council had lots of money, we wouldn't have had to have gone through that process. I'm responsible for making sure that the budgets are accurate, and I wouldn't have put the whole council, the members and the residents, through that process if we had lots of money. So, it is, council funding is very tight and we don't have money to spare. So with my section all my own hat on, you know, that's my integrity on the line there, so I just need to make that point. In terms of the membership of the Investment Change Board, I think the point I was making, apologies if I didn't make it quite correctly, was we haven't employed new members of staff to go on the Investment and Change Board. So members of staff and posts who were here, I have asked them to come on to the Investment and Change Board. So the council hasn't employed people specifically for the board. We have used the people who are here already, whether they were here 12 months ago or 2 years ago. I've just asked the people who, existing staff who were here at the time when they set it up, to come on board.
Okay, if we could come back on that, Chair said, it's very difficult to difficult to balance the budget. And yet, how much are we spending buying up assets? How much is this council spending buying up assets? Why have we got 700 homeless people in Wirral, 16 of them rough sleepers? We don't seem to have the money to help them, and yet we can go and buy a vacant building. There's something not quite right with the priorities of this council. It seems to want to buy everything up, give it to Muse, let them bring in lots of money. But hey, the young lads on the street who haven't got a home, who sleep in rot in freezing temperatures, is being left by this council. I find that incredible. So, and why did we ask a consultant to go on this board? If we haven't got enough competent council officers, then we need consultants. But I would hope that we had enough competent council officers that we wouldn't need a consultant on this board. I go back to last year, we employed we employed the head of housing and strategy resource, and you know, we employed him to take away the need for this particular consultant. And yet this particular consultant was kept by this council all the time that individual was employed. And according to the chief exec, it's £86,000 during that time. Absolutely incredible. If you've got no money and typical budgets, then why aren't we looking at where we can save money? Why are you looking for saying, well, we don't need to save money, we just need to buy something else? It's unbelievable. It's out of control, James. It really is. Out of control. It's out of control to me. It's out of control to the public. And we need to get a grip of our priorities.
I just like to, come back on the comments you've made there in terms of acquisition, property acquisitions. So there is a difference between capital and revenue funding. It could be a long discussion and a long debate, and I could quite happy to talk to you about any of the council members about it afterwards or on our outside meeting. But capital, we're allowed to use capital funding to buy assets. We're not allowed to use capital funding to provide day-to-day revenue and running of services. So we use capital to buy assets. We either use our balances for that, or we borrow money. We can borrow money really cheaply at the moment. What we do, so for example, what we would do is we could potentially buy an asset that would generate a rental income stream. What we can do is use that rental income stream there to provide money for our day-to-day service, running of services. So we buy assets to actually generate some income or some sort of investment to put into the day-to-day running of services. There's two different types of funding, and we can't use one for the other. So that's how we're able to do that and not. So for example, homeowners, we can't use the same money to buy an asset as we can use to provide homeowners. Any income that asset does generate could then go into providing the services for homeowners.
Do you think that some of your questions were about political choices and political priorities, and they're better addressed to the cabinet members who will actually be able to answer those questions? And thank you very much, Chair, for your report. I found it to be a higher salary than average of what we sometimes receive at scrutiny committees. I would like to know more about I like the idea of the gateway, that one place where ideas can be fed through. It'd be great to hear more. My suggestion is to open that opportunity up to a lot more people. We just, as a council, adopted the community wealth building programme and use people's socialism, and I know members of the Labour Party and the wider public are brimming with ideas about really exciting things, the creative things to generate and retain community wealth on the go. And how, so I'd like, I'm encouraging you to advertise that opportunity through case studies, what's been done so far, and how people can contribute their ideas and where they'll go up through the system.
Thank you, Chair. From a commercial business perspective, what you're proposing here is a very, very welcome change and a welcome improvement on the way things are done. Without throwing a Mickey Finn into this, I wonder how the funding and financial viability of this golf resort is going to fit into how this is going to be scrutinised, presumably using this panel. But that's a great concern to a lot of us, because we felt in the past that it's been a self-motivated thing that just carried on with its own momentum. And I just need you to try and tell me how the scrutiny, investment and change board is going to scrutinise and look at the financial viability otherwise of this golf resort involved the investment that the council taxpayers are putting into it. So can you just briefly comment on that for me, please?
Yeah, I will. Any proposals for Celtic Valley Golf Resort will come to investment and change board, and the whole board will have a look at that to scrutinise that definitely.
Any other questions? Councillor Mitchell.
Thank you, Chair. Quite interesting report. I'm reading that there's 12 members of the board, Will these all going to be followed too? Because there's no mention in this at all of where the end product is. I know when we had the briefing meeting, while I put it this, was a programme that broke down and we gave it to the board, which is to private sector and a couple of cabinet members. So how do we, as only members of this business collecting, actually need to know what's going on? Find out how these things go.
So the output from Investment Change Board is generally a business case, and the business case will be will come to Cabinet for key decision. So, the Investment Change Board doesn't specifically report anywhere, so there isn't another layer of another board or anything, another layer of governance. What happens is the outputs then go through our sort of internal processes that will eventually enter the Cabinet. So any business cases will come to our strategic leadership team, which is the top tier of the authority, and then it goes through to leadership, which is the leader of the council and the two deputies. Then it goes through to the strategic leadership team of the cabinet for discussion, and then it eventually goes through to the cabinet for approval. So that's the governance process that gets followed after investment change board.
Where is it then? Well, we find out when it's all been done rather than before.
So business cases for that need to be approved, key decisions come through to cabinet, and then I guess the role of scrutiny. You know, if there's anything that you want to scrutinise in advance, there's no problem or no issue with
How do you find that out?
We can't ask about it.
We don't know. Yeah.
Some matters will be from HR. So some matters that are going straight for decision obviously will be on a forward plan. So the forward plan is published and the intention, whilst the minimum is 28 days on the forward plan, the intention and desire is always to put things on the forward plan as far in advance as possible, which is why members will get a copy and you will be asking the cabinet members for free scrutiny. And then of course some themes are obviously on the forward are put to overview and scrutiny for pre-scrutiny process before decision. But that's always in the gift of the cabinet member to say this is something that we'd like a view from fellow members on before it comes to the decision rather than after.
Thank you. Can I just come back to
that? I'm mindful that I did say to Councillor Blakeley before other people wanted to speak, and I'm mindful Tom Usher wants to speak. He hasn't spoken on this yet, so I'll let you know.
What's in relation to those items just in that context? We don't know anything about the decision that's been made. As far as the selection is, it could be the wrong decision. Too late then, because it's already been made.
That's good. That's a good point on there. Councillor Usher.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to ask around the kind of how we separate these ideas into, you know, ideas that are commercially valuable, but also I think you referenced there, Chair, and that some of the ideas were dismissed or thrown out due to the non-aligned direction which the council wanted to sort of went ahead. Obviously becoming more commercial has been a relic of the council in recent years, these sound like maybe some fantastic changes and you know, a step in the right direction. But I was hoping that to get a sense of how this new arrangement measures perhaps the social value of some of the proposals, because at times in the pursuit of commercial value we can lose sight of some of the values that are equally or more important as an organisation like the council. And so I was wondering if there was a way in which we could, if that was taken into consideration, the social value of particular proposals, and just picking up on those ones really, how does each of the proposals, if they sort of pass through the board, and are deemed to be, you know, viable and desirable, is that then that proves the collective amount of business gives rather than capital member and they kind of write off the kind of they make a political decision around those proposals or how it's averages work.
Yeah, thank you for that. I guess it depends on the proposal. So we don't rule anything out of the board, so it's going to minimis level in terms of what's to come and what's not to come. There could be, I haven't got any specific examples, but there could be examples where we would consider social value. Is in terms of commerciality, a lot of perception of commerciality is it's all about income and charging income. It's not about that. We look at lots of different things in terms of how services can be designed differently or provided differently, or whether we're actually just providing the right value for money. Where an example could be where we would consider the social value is where there potentially could be a new charge that somebody might be asking to be implemented or to increase the charge. And then what we would do is actually look at that in terms of is that appropriate to increase the charge or is it appropriate to levy a charge at all? So, or if that's agreed or if we decide maybe we would consult with the cabinet member and yes, that's the next. So the next step really is to consult with the member of the government portfolio holder as to whether that would be appropriate under their portfolio. Conversations could be that where we might want to implement a new charge for something is that then we would also look at implementing a concession so that people who are unable to pay or it could be means tested or something like that. So the social value will be considered in any of the projects that would be considered.
Thanks, Chair. First of all, I think no apologies to Councillor Baird for bringing forward the plight of the homeless and more sleep as it will as a priority of this council. I asked at the outset. I did not interrupt you. Please don't.
Councillor Baird, come on, question, please.
I asked at the outset, what is an ACG? What is a PMO? We got Head of Digital, SIRO. What are all these acronyms? What do they mean? Because they mean nothing to me.
Thank you, Chair. So the terms of reference you've got there is an internal document. I appreciate that it's actually gone with the papers and, foreign measures, and I should have spotted that and actually made a note that actually to put those in full. So just in terms of answering your questions, ACG is Assets and Capital Board, which is on the last slide.
Assets and Capital Board?
Assets and Capital Group, sorry. Okay. Yeah. PMO is the Programme Management Office. What are the other ones that you asked for?
SIRO.
Can I ask the Management Officers to respond to that one?
SIRO actually, if members is me. The Senior Information Risk Officer. There'll also be in the SRO as the Senior Responsible Officer in terms of project management. So, local government loves its acronyms, there's a lot here. I said that's our apologies for internal blocking.
Yeah, Chair. Thanks for the answers. Like I say, on some of these acronyms, there is an explanation next to them. But equally on most of them, there's no explanation next to them. Is this document in the public domain?
No, it isn't, so it's an internal document.
Okay. Will it go in the public domain as part of the minutes? And if it does, can I ask that all these acronyms are fully explained?
Yes, any acronyms that are in there will be fully explained. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Don't forget, Councillor Blakeley, saving the trip on that offer to meet him. So, one of the issues which I'm sure it's not time for tonight. Okay, thank you for that report. Thank you for those answers. Those questions, should I say. Very interesting, illuminating. Thank you very much for the chair. Okay, on to number six, budget proposal, scrutiny, workshop report. If I can just give an outline on my thoughts of the workshop itself. Unfortunately, the workshop, I thought personally, didn't work too well. I thought we didn't have enough time to discuss and to take in the information before us. I don't think there was enough information, maybe down to 280, maybe we should have asked for more. I also thought the number of projects that came before us as Miss Elder's chair and the party spokes was a huge list, and we would not have been able to give it due consideration and analysis on the time that we had, without a doubt. So that was whittled down to three or four proposals, which was agreed by myself, the vice chair, and the party spokes, to come before the workshop on the night. I have to say, unfortunately, due to clashes with other events and meetings and other commitments, a lot of members were not able to make it on the evening, and as a result, it wasn't many of us there to discuss or even to make any decisions on the proposals before us. We also asked questions, myself and the Labour group. They can write the same, and they can tell us whether I'm right or wrong. The Conservative group made a statement before the meeting, gave the reasons why they were not going to take part in the meeting, and that's recorded in the that's recorded, those reasons, in the report. But to be fair to them, they did take part. After saying that, in the meeting, took a full proper part in the meeting. As I say, I don't really think the meeting was as productive as it should have been, for a whole host of reasons. And we also had the officers who were there answered questions that were put. I certainly wasn't happy with a number of questions on the night that I asked to the previous director of jobs and growth. He wasn't there a few days later, he was left the authority. So that's my brief take on the budget workshop. I am going to put forward something at the end to bear the comments from members. And I'm sure the officers might want to make comments. I decided you were there all the night. Any questions, Stephen?
Not a question as such, just to clarify, you touched on what we said at the start of the meeting. What we have said for this meeting is that we do not believe that the workshop is the appropriate way for the Cabinet's budget proposals to be considered by that committee. We also said that it should be held in public at a formal meeting where the committee is now recorded.
Two questions, because unfortunately I went over that particular. I believe my colleague Councillor Alan Drain said it in my heart. It's not recorded in the attendance.
No, it's not.
He was there. He was
there. I could just clarify that particular point.
Councillor Jerry Williams.
Yeah, again, just to highlight the fact that one of the particular problems, and of course I was there passing with you, one of the problems on the night there was the clashing of these workshops. The officers are putting these workshops together and not checking on what workshops are going on particular nights, and it's causing an absolute nightmare. And I think there was a children's scrutiny workshop on that night. There was a Trammy Rovers event, council event of some sort on that night. And the officers, we could ask politely for the officers to take this into consideration in the future, because how can we take on things democratically if we're having meetings clashing with each other and also being called at very short notice? I would just like that minister, I mean, that doesn't I've already spoken to a couple of the council officers about doing this, and I would just like to have minutes of each reference. Thank you.
Councillor Usher. I've just got a quick question on the asset management aspect of the budget proposals report. Obviously, this is my first business committee meeting as a Rangers and Bonds committee in Blakeley, Guild Ward. So it wouldn't really be appropriate for me to comment on the budget workshop as I wasn't there, and I don't know how much information was forthcoming or what aren't. But I was just hoping to ask around Dominic House and how Dominic House, which is up for, I think, the freehold is being sold. I don't know if there's anyone here to actually answer the job in the report, but I just wondered how long it was had been empty for, and what price it was being sold for. And why we were selling freehold and not the leasehold, and have there been any expressions of interest from any organisations and any sectors for voluntary in using the building for all tenants.
Thank you.
You're right, it is an asset at sort of disposal. I don't know the answer to your questions, unfortunately, but I'll certainly find that out for you.
Thank you. I'm sorry I wasn't able to attend that workshop due to illness, but I've noticed there was more officers there than members. One of the officers is Brian Bailey, who departed 2 days later. I'm wondering what is the impact of that departure and what's happening about fulfilling that role.
Chair, sorry to interrupt, I'm very happy to go to another meeting. You please accept
me. Of course, absolutely.
Thank you.
At the moment, the corporate director for business management is also in that role on an interim basis. So he's picking up the two staff who reported to that role, reported directly to him. And we're currently looking at arrangements as to how to replace that role.
Thank you. There's no other. See you later.
Cheers.
Thanks.
Thanks, Chair. I'm going to agree with Jerry here, because you know, the reason there were so many touches, Jerry, is because workshops don't appear in time. So as well as other people not getting no control on that life, neither do I select the council officers. And that's why we've always said these should be full committee meetings, dialogue, open to the public, and then there will not be any clashes. And just going back, there was five of us here, six of us, because I told Steve Allegrain was here, and he wasn't on the thing. There were six of us here, hour 15, so not even half. And it was difficult. We did play our part. We made a statement that we would not be supporting any budget proposals in favour or against. We just would not be. But we would ask questions and comments, and we certainly did that. Thanks, Chair.
Chair.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just in terms of the diarisation of those, there's no reason why those can't go in the diary straight away. So when we do the diary planning for the new municipal year in May, I'll make sure that those are included in the diaries.
If I may, Chair, the officers deliberately not put them in the diary so that members of the public don't say that.
Thank you for those comments. There's any more before we move on to the person. Mindful of what I said before, I'd like to put forward a recommendation at the end. Is there any more comments now?
Okay.
I'd like to read this out for me. I've given it, I suppose, but change it now slightly in place of further comments from the floor. Agree we note the report, but take out on the last page in the conclusions where it says no objections to proposals were raised at the workshop. As the saying was, objections raised at the to begin on a number of issues, for the reasons said before. So, the green remembering board will take out on the conclusions. No objections to the proposal were raised at the workshop. And further, we felt we were not able to give due and proper consideration to the matters before us because we needed more information forthcoming in advance. The timetable is too short, or is too short, and puts too much pressure on members and officers to allow full and proper scrutiny. And finally, due to members, as we mentioned, due to members' other commitments, it meant it was impossible to make a full and informed analysis of the proposals before us. And we therefore asked Cabinet to note the comments of the Scrutiny Committee.
Chair, I
propose that. Yeah. We've got a second then. Jeremy Williams.
Chair, I have an amendment to that based on much of what you've said, but maybe slightly more direct. Perhaps we could incorporate some of this into the opening as well. I'll read out what we have produced for the budget workshop. We will note the reports. We felt that we were not able to give full and proper consideration to the matter before us because, one, not enough information was forthcoming, two, the timetable is too short, and three, the committee does not believe a workshop held in private is a right and proper. And these important matters should be held in an open and transparent manner. Committee therefore informs Cabinet that we are unable to make any budget recommendations.
Is there a second?
Yes,
Can I just say, I did speak to all sides beforehand. One of the things I didn't mention is that we had, as part of the Scrutiny Chairs, meeting, we all agreed that we need to look at and review, they're obviously going to do that, review the budget scrutiny process. So all these issues are going to take on board anyway by all of us during that process. And to be honest, yours is very similar to what we've done. I don't see much difference. So
maybe the last point, Chair.
Just the last point. Well,
that's the last point of yours, and we'll vote for it.
No, they are. The last point is different. So the proposal is to the Councillor Usher.
Just quickly, Chair, I have a lot of sympathy with all the points that have been made about the budget process. And, as a Chair of Children, we've spoken about this and, we'll be asking for sort of, certain things to be considered next year. But considering that I wasn't actually at the workshop that we're talking about, I don't think it'd be right for me to weigh in one way or the other, so I just wanted to have that noted and then know that I'll be abstaining.
I'd just like to understand the process
more proof to